Am I in trouble being out here with you tonight?
Maybe. Oh, boy.
Back in 1991, Reba's band made tragic headlines when their small plane crashed into the San Diego mountains, killing 7 band members and her tour manager.
Pieces of the wreckage are strewn all about that mountain.
Reba had skipped the flight at the urging of her husband and manager, Narvel Blackstock. Through it all, Reba has kept on singing, even when the headlines sound like the lyrics of a country song.
Now you must think I'm blind and I don't smell your new cologne. You don't think I know this all the nights I've been alone.
Ladies and gentlemen, Reba McEntire.
Kid.
Oh, well, that's nice. Thank you.
Thank you, not too.
Woo. You're a real cowgirl. This is a shocker to me. I'll tell you what, you're not from the suburbs.
No. I'm from the country.
Something else, too. You are sexy up there.
Well,
I mean,
thank
you know,
you
do this.
I can't do it quite as well as you can.
No, that's true. Of course not. No kidding. A real ranch with real cattle, and you were a real cowpoke.
Yes.
For your daddy.
Yes.
Who was not the warmest, lovey-dovey kind of cowpoke in Oklahoma either.
No, Daddy was real serious, real businesslike. He was to the point, and he wasn't very good at explaining things either. So when he told us kids, he said, all right, now y'all go over there. Now, we'd be back here. Y'all go over there and get over across the pole fence, and y'all get those cattle and bring them on home. And he'd ride off. Then all of us kids would huddle up together and say, what'd he say?
And by how old were you when you would be sent off, literally, to find
I probably started riding and helping gathering cattle when I was about 6 or 7.
That would seem to make you just the biggest tomboy ever was.
Oh, I was. Very muchly so. That's why I didn't have very many boyfriends, as you saw in the book.
Yes.
I can name both of them.
Talking about your daddy, he kept a buggy whip above the door frame, and he'd get it down and snap it across one of us kids' behinds if we thought we needed it.
If he thought we needed it, yeah.
He never warned us. He never even told us we were getting on his nerves. He just let us have it.
Mm-hmm.
But you never had a war with your dad. Isn't that interesting? You know, a lot of, you know, that we're hearing stories now about scars and memories and abuse and all that, even with this old-fashioned kind of...
Well, it was one of those straight buggy whips. You know, it just popped at the end. It wasn't that bad. And we probably deserved it very much because we were a very working family. And we worked hard. We played hard. And well, I get a lot of my determination and my ambition from Daddy. No, I never had a falling out with Daddy.
Mm-hmm. You also...
Well, I did, too. I'll tell you that in a little bit.
Some of the many memories of your book include your daddy had triple bypass.
Uh-huh.
I'm talking like I'm from Oklahoma now, Daddy. Here he is with all the tubes, and boy, I mean, that's a... Anybody who's had a loved one go through this knows that that's scary looking down in that
scary.
Bed.
Yeah.
But we should say he's... Alive and well, and so is your mother.
They're doing fine.
Did you hold his hand?
Yeah, I was fixing to go get on the bus. We were in Tulsa, Oklahoma.
This is in the 80s, during the 80s?
87. 1987, and Daddy was in the hospital at Tulsa, and I went in to say goodbye to him because he'd just come out of surgery. They said everything was fine. He's doing real good. He was still real groggy from all the painkillers or whatever they knocked him out with. And when I went in there, I said, well, Daddy, I got to go to Chattanooga tonight. I'm leaving now. He said, okay, honey. Everything's all right. I love you. And I looked around. I said, well, who's he talking to? Because Daddy has never told any of us that he loved us. We knew he did. It's kind of like the song, The Greatest Man I Never Knew. He never said it, but, you know, he provided for us. He took care of us. So I knew he loved us. It's not like Mama. Mama's a very affectionate woman.
Mm-hmm. But it isn't something that hurt you. You understood this is the way daddies in Oklahoma behave, and it doesn't mean they don't love you.
Well, a lot of my friends, their daddy said that, and my Uncle Slim told Paula Ricky and Doris Jean that, they, you know, our cousins, that he loved them, but Daddy just wasn't that kind.
Yeah. Boy, aren't you, where would these folks be without you, girl? You're selling a whole bunch of papers. I mean, I bought some of these myself.
Oh,
stopped me cold at the airport. Are you kidding? Shocking charge by two ex-wives. Reba stole our husband. Boy, I'll tell you what. I read that all the way to Los Angeles. Heartbroken Reba. Why I won't have more kids. You are selling the magazines. You're just so darned interesting.
And, you know, that's funny to me. I thought my life was kind of boring. But they sure made it a lot spicier than it is.
Yeah. Well, it hasn't exactly been uneventful, let's
just
say.
No, we've had a couple of things that have been very eventful. But all in all, when they came to me and asked me to write this book, I said, well, give me 10 years and I'll have something for you. And they said, oh, no, we'll give you 9 months.
Uh-huh.
And I was just like, 9 months? I mean, I'm only 39 years old, 38 when I started writing it. But still, I thought that was an awful lot of short time.
An awful lot of things happened on your bus.
Yes.
You got a big, well, well, you
and
know,
when
I
you
always
said that,
wanted.
I thought he knows something I don't know.
Well,
who you been talking to?
I've been reading your book.
Okay, then say.
Well, you and Charlie are not ahead, and it's not going too well.
Yeah.
And he, you're doing a music video, and you've got to go from site to site. And he leans out the butt. He's up front, and you're back in your room. I assume that must be some pretty room in the back.
You
got a big. Is it a queen size or?
Well, the bus I had, I don't have a bus anymore, but it was a full size bed.
Uh huh. Nice little curtains on the window and all that.
Little mirrors and
you got
lights
little vanity. Kind of nice. So you and he are having problems, and he stops at a flower vendor. He's in another part of the bus, and he buys one rose, and he comes back and he sets it on the bed right next to you, and you could have killed him.
Yeah.
Why?
Well, because we were having a lot of problems, and he kind of thought that that would make it all right. That would fix it. And the problems were a lot deeper than that.
And then he reveals to you that he took $400 out of your purse.
Mm-hmm.
He is your husband, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, husbands and wives do that. I mean, it's not like he was sneaking it, was he? I mean, it wasn't a... He told you about it.
Yeah, he told me about it after he took it.
But you just... Yeah. Well, why did it upset you?
I think at the point that I was at in you know, my mind, I'd already made up my mind that the marriage was over with, and things had already started dividing up in my mind. And so for him to go ahead and think that everything was still fine and dandy...
Was an example of everything about him that made you so angry. He didn't get it.
Exactly. He didn't realize there was anything wrong.
And this little rose is going to do it, and you said that just made you all
even
the more angry.
Yeah. Exactly.
So finally he got it.
Yeah, when the divorce papers were served to him, he got it. He understood it then. I don't really think he even thought anything that I would go through a divorce procedure at all. Mm-hmm. I don't think he ever thought I would divorce him.
You are very honest about the details of this divorce settlement in the book.
Mm-hmm.
He got, how big is it? 200 acre ranch?
Yeah, over 200 acre ranch. We bought it when we'd been married 4 years.
Mm-hmm.
And he
what
got
year
ranch.
Was this final? 1980-something.
1988, probably. It was settled early part of 88. I filed in 87.
He got the 200-acre ranch. He incidentally wanted 10% of everything you make for the rest of your life.
Yeah.
So would I. That didn't work, huh?
No.
I mean, he obviously, you know.
No.
And he got 540,000 green ones from you. You know, that's not awful. I mean, really, I mean, from your point of view, you're number one artist. You are a seven-figure artist, 120-plus dates a year. You know, no telethons for you, Reba. So I just, from the outside looking in, sounds like a pretty fair deal to me.
Right now, I would... not think twice about doing it again. Even the next day, I would have done. It was worth it. Very glad I did it. I'm a happy person today. And if it was three times that much, I'd still work hard to pay it off.
Mm-hmm. And you're still amicable. You see him? No.
No.
You don't see him?
Haven't seen him since we divorced.
Okay. Now you have a steel guitar player.
Mm-hmm.
And he's on the bus, too.
Mm-hmm.
And his name is Narvel Blackstock.
Mm-hmm.
Narvel Blackstock. That's going to be my name in my next life.
Phil Blackstock.
You liked him all the time. I mean, he was a real good dude right from the start, huh? Good musician, good. You got along well?
Very well. Narvel and I really got along business well, business sense. But there was never a time when we were, the 10 years that we traveled together, from 1980 to, well, I'd say before me and Charlie divorced, when we would all be out, all me and the band, Narvel and I never had an iota inkling of ever having a romantic feeling toward each other.
No, you were just, for several years, you were on tour together, you worked together, he was always kind to you.
Very, very professional.
No romantic thing at all.
He thought I was a country bumpkin and I thought he was a city slicker.
Huh. So, after like 6 or 7 years on the bus, if I'm understanding the chronology here, one day he ups and kisses her right on the lips.
No, I kissed him.
You're applauding this? He's not even divorced yet.
I'm a red-headed hussy.
I'll tell you, these New York audiences, I'm telling you. She is not yet divorced, and neither is he. Who cares? Come on. So, boy, and they don't, and that's all it was, too, just that one kiss that time.
Yeah.
Nothing followed up, none of this stuff like you see.
We were good kids.
Pretty soon, he's in bed with his wife, and he calls his wife Reba. That's a true story.
That's very true. But once you work with people day to day, and you, you're with, well, honestly, all of me and my organization were around each other a lot more than we were our families.
Mm-hmm.
One summer, we left when the guys' kids got out of school, and we got back when they went back to school. The whole summer long, we were out on the road. So once you stay out with people, and once you get back with your spouse, you do happen to, once in a while, call them by somebody else's name.
It happens. It happens. It happens. Reba, my story. Who else is Reba? Here is one of the most exciting, talked about. Everybody wants to know about Reba. And all she does is have hit after hit. I'm telling you, you've won just about everything. And yes, she will perform for us. The first song is titled, Why Haven't I Heard From You? And she will sing it for us when we come back with Reba McEntire in just a moment. Why haven't I heard from you? Go get him, girl. Reba McEntire.
An old boy named Bell invented a contraption that we know so well. By the 1950s, they're in everybody's home. It's a crazy little thing they call the telephone. Now there's one on every corner, in the back of every bar. You can get one in your briefcase, on a plane, or in your car. So tell me why. If this all confuses you, so tell me why. Thunder.
For you, woman, and we'll ask him when we come back in just a moment.
Because when I'm singing a song, I can look down the front row and see women doing this, just boogaloo.
Tell me why.
We're back with Reba. Yes, ma'am.
Hi. Reba, with those incidents that happened with the plane, are you at all fearful of flying? You almost have to, I know nowadays, to get from one place to another. Do you
no,
think
I'm
about
not
it?
Afraid of flying. Matter of fact, the day that the plane crash happened, that we got right back on an airplane and flew home. I think that's the best means of transportation for me, and I'm not afraid of it.
But no, most folks would not be that brave. This is a remarkable thing. You just decided to seize this fear, then you had to feel it.
Absolutely, and also I came to the realization that when it's your time to go, it's your time to go. And no matter if I walk out my back door of the house, I mean, I could fall and break my neck. It's just just something I got over.
And it was just a matter of months after the fatal accident that killed your band members and your tour manager that you had a scare on your own airplane.
Yes, it was in November of 92.
And your wheels were half in the half position.
Uh-huh.
Not all the way up, not all the way down.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the front landing gear.
And how did the pilot said come back and say, Reba, we got a small problem here, or how?
I knew we had a small problem because I you know, you're used to where you're hearing it go up and down, and it didn't go up right, and we knew it didn't. And so we had to fly around Nashville to burn off fuel before we could make an emergency landing. And when we did land, we got off that plane and got back on another plane and went to Madison, Wisconsin for my date. And I was only about 10 minutes late.
Yes.
Thanks, Phil. Reba, by the way, that was wonderful. The band sounded great, too, if you don't mind
Thank
me saying.
You.
By the way, did you get sick of just picking up the tabloids, Reba this, Reba that? Is that what made you write the book?
The tabloids and other press getting the facts wrong about the divorce and about the plane crash. Yes, that was. I wanted to have my side of the story.
I'm curious, Reba, when did you go from rounding up cattle to knocking everybody's socks off singing? When did
That's
that happen
a good
for you?
Question.
You're sweet. Thank
first
you very
of all,
much.
You tell them about your rodeo days. This is you're a serious rodeo person.
Well, I was more serious than my competitors thought I was. I never did win anything. I won about two buckles and enough money to get me to the next rodeo and pay my entry fees. But I rodeoed from the time I was 11 till I was 21. And in between all that, I was singing at every function I could, from the first grade Christmas program, singing Away in the Manger, to the fifth grade when I sang my Sweet Little Alice Blue Gown. And anytime they let me sing, I'd be singing.
Fifth grade was the first time you stood behind a microphone?
No, the first grade.
First grade?
Yeah.
You don't forget that?
No, no. And then the fifth grade was when the first time I got to dress up in a costume.
Uh-huh. Your first husband during those troubles raised a shaving kit. But he never did touch you, did he?
No, I don't think he would have hit me then, really.
No man has ever struck you. Except your father.
Yeah.
Well, this is a good thing. We want to figure out how we get all the girls this smart. Seriously.
Absolutely. I wouldn't put up with it.
One strike and he's out, is it? Isn't that so?
Yeah, if I'm not out first.
Yeah. Now, one of the things that really made you angry when he just threatened you with that, you gave him that shaving kit. And he had two children when he married you.
Uh-huh.
And he let his child tear that present open.
Yeah.
And it hurts your feelings.
Well, I was a very immature young bride. I had gotten Charlie a shaving kit, had it hand-tooled. It was a very pretty leather shaving kit. And I had it made for him with his name and his brand on it, his brand that we brand cattle with. And when I presented it to him for Christmas, of course, the whole family was there and his two young children were there. And he let his kids open the present that I had given him, which he didn't see anything wrong with it. And the kids, being kids, just tore the wrapping paper off of it real quick, just ripped it off. And then, you know, it kind of fell on the floor and he picked it up. And I went to the bathroom and cried because it hurt my feelings. And so after that, we had a strong talk about, from now on, you open my gift to you and I'll open your gift to me. And it will be a very personal, private thing.
He had no idea he was hurting your feelings.
No, no. Huh. Charlie's a very rugged cowboy. He learned a lot about it because I would kind of throw fits and tell him what upset me.
Yeah, but let's not leave this now. We've got some black and blue women out there. This is really pretty awful, and I think some of them come up to you after concerts and personal appearances. You see a lot of pain out there in your audience among not a few of your female fans. Do I understand this?
Well, they can relate to my music, if that's what you're saying, because when I'm singing a song, I can look down the front row and see women doing this, just boohooing. So evidently, something that I'm singing has really touched them deeply.
Right. But for a young girl to grow up in Oklahoma, where men are men and men do what they have to do and the men are in charge and you better believe it because this is the way the world is, girl, and don't you better not argue with me because I got a whip right here. This can bring out of this culture a whole lot of women who grow up thinking that really they can't do anything without a man's permission. Or a man can do anything without their... You know what I'm saying to
yes,
you?
I
How
do.
Did you escape that?
It was the competition level that I always wanted to beat the boys. And it started with Pake, my older brother. We'd run out of the house, and the first thing we'd say to each other is, anything you can do, I can do better. And I don't care if it's arm wrestling or throwing a rock or doing chin-ups, push-ups, or foot race. I'd try to beat him every time. He's 2 years older than I was, too. It was that competition that was the thing that wanted me to get away from the male dominance.
Right. So you could flirt with the best of them, but you could also, you could see, if a man was sort of inclined to drag him around by the hair, you could spot it early and got out of there quickly. Is that right?
Yes, I could detect that.
Reba's latest CD is titled Read My Mind, and it is on this CD that... you'll find what you just sang for, why haven't I heard from you? Hey, there's a telephone on every corner. Come on. And yes, Ms. McEntire performs for us again when she comes back in just a moment. Well, Reba, they're never calling you chicken. I mean, no kidding. This isn't funny. This is a wonderful, wonderful piece of music, and I want you to sell 7 gazillion records. But if you tell somebody in Nashville that you're going to sing about this, they're going to tell you that you need some help with your career because they're not going to go for this at all. Was it tough to get this recorded, written, sung?
No, actually...
It's titled, His Name Was John. I think his name was John.
She thinks his name was John.
Right. Well, let's not tell him. Why don't you just sing it for us here?
All right,
here.
I'll sing it for you.
All right. Listen to this now.
John. Chance meeting a party a few years back, broad shoulders and blue eyes. His hair was so black, he was a friend of a friend, you could say. She just let his smile just sweep her away. And in her heart, she knew it was wrong, but too much wine, and she left his bed at dawn, and she thinks his name was John. Now listen to these final two stanzas here. Now each day is one day that's left in her life, and she won't know love, have a marriage, or sing lullabies. She lays all alone and cries herself to sleep, because she let a stranger kill her hopes and her dreams. And all her friends say that what a pity, what a loss. And in the end, when she was barely hanging on, all she could say is she thinks his name was John. She thinks his name was John. The guy gave her AIDS. Now, how's that for? Don't you tell me Nashville backs up from the big stuff here. I don't imagine this was easy, though, was it?
No, it wasn't easy. It wasn't an easy song to sing.
No, of course not, but I mean, who would want
to
put it on an album? It's too painful. It's too... Who was
the... Oh, it needed to be said. It needed to be a song that was out to the public. And I've always been the type that if I find a good song, very well written, where the message is there, not preachy,
right,
but it's there, and if it could help in some way, some shape, form, or fashion,
yeah,
then I'll sing it in a heartbeat.
Well, you have my admiration, and so does the producer, the writer, and most certainly the performer. And we'll be back in just a moment. 9 years old. That means you had a baby at 30-something.
35.
Just like most, lots of women today.
Uh-huh.
And you didn't even lie down for the delivery. It was a walk in the park. You talk about this in your book, too,
uh-huh,
and it wasn't a walk in the park. You want to just... This was, I tell you what, this got your attention, didn't it?
Yes, it did. You know, I loved being pregnant. I had the best time. I did have a lot of complications, though. Shelby, I started having early contractions, like in my fifth month, and so I had to go to bed, and I was put in the hospital twice and put on certain medications, try to stop the labor pains from coming. But boy, it was the greatest experience I've ever had in my entire life.
I bet you.
Wonderful.
Uh-huh. But it was a long labor, wasn't it?
Well, my water broke at 9:25 Friday night, and then I had him the next morning at 5:04. So,
well,
in some terms, it wasn't too bad.
No. And the baby weighed?
6 pounds, 10 ounces.
Mm-hmm. And that's about it for the babies, is it?
I think so. Narval already has, counting Shelby, 4 children. So, you know, when you have an 18-year-old and a 2-year-old, that's when Shauna, his oldest, was 18 and Shelby was 2. That pretty much blows any illusions you have of raising a kid. 18 and a 2-year-old, there's, you know, both ends of the spectrum.
Yeah.
So he said, I think that's enough for me. Oh, I could have 10 more. I think they're the most fun.
Who was invited to this event? I mean, nowadays, you know, you got a coach and a breathing coach and a... You didn't do this?
No.
I mean, did you take all those blocks?
No, I didn't take Lamaze, because, I mean, if I'd done any of that, I'd already had him. But it was just Narval and myself at the hospital, and when we started out for the hospital, we're about 35, 40 minutes out of Nashville.
Right.
And so when we were in the car driving, Narval got to drive 100 miles an hour, so he was thrilled. Into the hospital, we called my mother and daddy, and then his mother and daddy.
Yeah.
And my mother flew in, and so did his mom and daddy.
One other thing before this audience has more than a few questions for you, but this red dress.
Yeah.
Well, that got my attention.
I can see that. And it got my mother's, too.
Yeah. Let me show you here. Well, my dear. Uh-huh. Light up the room. Got all the boys talking there. Well, you liked it when you put it on, didn't you?
Well, see, that was the first time I'd had it on since it was finished. And I was in the dressing room there at the Opera House where the CMA Awards show was. And I just put it on.
Country Music Awards, yes.
I just put it on and looked in the mirror, and we had to go right quick. And so I was out. Narva walked in the room and looked at me like, he said, Sandy Speakum, my designer, he said, I thought you were going to put more sequins on that. She said, oh, I did. And he said, oh. And so I just walked out on stage not thinking a thing about it.
And then pretty soon everybody in Nashville and lots of other places were talking about your dress.
Well, when I walked out on stage and everybody went, I kind of thought, what is it? You know, I didn't dare look down, you know.
Reba, I commend you. You're an incredibly strong woman. And
thank
my
you.
Question to you is, how do you keep a happy homestead with all your children, 18 to 2 years old? How do you see them? How do you play with them? How do you see them growing up? What do you do to have a happy homestead?
Well, the 3 older children live in Wyoming with their mother, Narval's first wife. And then Shelby's at home, and since I do fly back and forth from my shows, I get to spend a lot of time at home. And then I'm very fortunate enough that I get to take him with me to my job. He has fun with it. He likes it.
Yes. Reba, you're 39, done a lot in the time you've got. What ambitions do you have left?
Oh, I have lots of ambitions, lots of things I'd like to do. Star in more movies, maybe work maybe on a Broadway play someday. I've thought about a lot of more television things to do, and then that's also with my 125 to 127 dates a year that I get to tour.
Yeah. So you're going to continue this pace then. Incidentally, no more bus. That's a disappointment. That's my next life. I'm going to have a bus life. That's neat. Have all those people surrounding your bus cheering for you. You're inside taking a bath. Fabulous. And I assume you didn't say Reba on the side of the bus. You don't want to do that, no. No.
Yes. Reba, I want to ask you about the popularity of country music. In Pulse Magazine this month, they say that it either has peaked or it's near its peak. Do you feel the pressure of keeping a number one album, or how do you feel about the popularity of country music right now?
I always am under pressure trying to beat my last project, whether it's the album or our show, whatever it is. We always try to beat it and do better. I don't see any way in the world that country music is fixing to peak. The attendance at our concerts are getting bigger. There are more people liking country music and of all age groups. So I think it's just going to get bigger and better.
Yeah. It's a fact, though, that mainstream media buries country music every 3 or 4 years. It's a cycle. And all that happens is that it becomes, add another billion to the kind of revenue. This is, and you never were a singer with... My baby left me, and I'm at the truck stop, and I'm going to drink a pint of whiskey, so it'll be all over. Yet, your material does come from the heart, and you're proud of that.
I'm very proud of it. I love songs that really can touch people.
Yes. You have a duet for us coming up with Linda Davis.
And, my favorite singer.
And we'll come back as you perform in a moment with your favorite singer.
Okay.
We are pleased to present Reba McEntire, who will be joined shortly after the beginning of this wonderful ballad by Linda Davis. Reba and Linda, does he love you? I wonder myself.
Does he love you like he's been loving me?
Why Haven't I Heard From You, and I think his name was John, is on this, she thinks his name was John, is on this album. Reba, your latest CD titled Read My Mind, 2 Grammys, 30 awards. Linda Davis, well, you ain't even jealous, girl. Look at this. How well you guys get along. You liked her right away, did you?
Oh, absolutely. First time I ever heard her sing, fell in love with her music. Well, then I fell in love with her because she's a great gal.
Don't you make music together, and we'll be back in just a moment.